Our tears draw in the Savior. The Bible says He is nigh unto them that are of a contrite spirit in the book of Psalms. And it's good to know our scripture when we listen into music, if we know if it's accurate or not. Amen. But it is. Praise the Lord. That one was. Amen and amen. 1 Samuel chapter 1 is where we're at. And I will give you a little bit of hope. I know a lot of you think that I kind of act like I'm drugged up a lot, but I'm not, I promise you, okay? I got rid of that. This is the way I believe. You can take it or you can leave it. This is my opinion's about to come out. You ready for that? Okay? My opinion's about to come out. Just because the doctor tells you to take some drugs doesn't mean that you have to. Just to say that. You understand all that the Lord has asked me to have with diabetes and different things. And I've been prescribed a lot of things. I haven't taken them all. Why? Because I think you should do your research and know what you're taking. Some people just prescribe things. Well, but anyways, praise the Lord. There is no hard stuff today. Praise God for Tylenol. Amen. Okay. All right, so I believe I'm in my right mind. If you'd follow me, I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to do something today, all right? And so follow me if you would. 1 Samuel chapter 1 is where we'll be. This is Hannah, of course. Many of us, most of us, would know this passage of Scripture and know this account of the Scripture here and what takes place. It's easy to assume that Hannah she has a fleshly want. It's easy to assume that, meaning, well, I don't have a son, and this other woman has plenty of children, and I just want something of my own. And it's easy to assume that, and it's easy to see when she's being harassed, if I can say it that way, by this other woman. You don't have children. You're barren. Oh, look at you. Don't you wish you were like me? And, of course, the Bible teaches us we aren't to compare ourselves with one another. Okay, everybody's different. I don't know why. That sometimes the Lord allows these folks to go through this or to have this or to do that, and other folks are not. Okay, that's not up to us. That's up to God. We've got to trust and we've got to obey no matter what our circumstances are. Amen. God desired Hannah to have faith just like He desires me to have faith. And we don't understand all these things. Why is it that people that don't know how to raise children can have children just so easily, and other folks that would raise them right and treat them right and take them to church and teach, and yet the God hasn't allowed all these things? It's not for us. Listen, it's not for us to start blaming God and pointing the finger at God. It's for us to trust and obey. And He takes us through things that we don't always understand. Hannah here, she's struggling. She has a desire. And yet, we see Penina here. Now, let's just deal with this and jump off of it. There's a second wife here. Okay, it's Old Testament. These men did this. God didn't approve of it, never did. If He approved of it, He would have given Adam a second wife. He didn't. He gave him one, didn't He? He said, one wife, and you're going to come together. Two shall be one flesh. He didn't say three or four or five. He said two. Gave him one wife, and they came together. And man, man being man. This was the beginning of 1 Samuel is the time of the judges. And the judges, what we find is in the book of Judges, is that every man did that which was right in his own eyes. That's what it says over and over again. And seems to be a kind of a theme there. And Elkanah here, the husband, has two wives. And wouldn't you know it, there's turmoil in the home. There's some harassment going on. There's some issues. We saw that same thing with Jacob, right? Abraham, listen, God said, Abraham, I'm going to give you a son in your old age. And he took it upon himself and took on a handmaid and had a second wife. And God didn't bless the fruit of that womb, did He? He did not. He said, that's not the son I promised you. And so we understand that. We have things recorded in Scripture that are not always God's way. We have the book of Job, and we have all the friends of Job saying a lot of things. They're not all true. God corrects them. He gives us here examples of different things, and that doesn't mean that every life and every little thing was approved by God. We understand that. All right. Now, as we move right along here, we have Hannah. Hannah doesn't have any children. I believe Hannah is spiritually minded. I do. Why do you say that, Pastor? Because I see in, verse number 7. It says, "And as he did so year by year, when she went up to the house of the Lord, she provoked her." Talking about Penina provoking Hannah here. "Provoked her, and therefore she wept and did not eat." Wait a minute. She went to the house of God. She didn't eat and she wept. What does that mean? That means she was fasting and bringing her prayers before the Lord. That's what that means. Why wouldn't you eat? Because she's denying her physical body something that it wants, that it needs, because the spiritual need is greater than the physical. She's going to God and saying, "Lord, I believe this blessing is going to come from you, so I'm going to show you that I mean business, and I'm going to deny myself." That's what fasting is. We deny ourselves of food. Sometimes you can fast from other things. Okay? I fast from coffee a lot. No, I'm teasing. Okay, I don't drink coffee, all right? But we can fast from certain things. We can. But sometimes God has, in the New Testament, we saw where demons were needing to be cast out and the disciples couldn't cast them out. And he said, "These come out by prayer and fasting." God, we can get a hold of God when we're fasting. We need to understand that. Now, here, Hannah is she's going without food. She's spiritually minded. She goes to the Lord for this request. All right? Help me with that if you would, please. Somebody's phone's going off. Thank you for that. All right? So, she fasted before the Lord. She was not concerned. Watch this now. She was not concerned on the physical here so much. Look at verse 8. "Then said Elkanah to her husband to her, 'Hannah, why weepest thou, and why eatest thou not? And why is thy heart grieved? Am not I better to thee than 10 sons?'" Sure, she had a great husband. But she said, "I have a desire, and I'm taking it to the Lord." She was spiritually minded. She took it to the Lord. Look at verse 10. "And she was in bitterness of soul and prayed unto the Lord and wept sore." We don't see Hannah running to Eli complaining. We don't see Hannah running to her husband whining and complaining, all these things. She went to God. She was spiritually minded. She said, "I have a great desire, and I'm going to take it to God. I'm going to let God take care of it." Okay? And so we see that here. This family would come up. We've read it here in the scripture already. This family would come up once every year to where the tabernacle was. Now, I say tabernacle. It was not the temple. This is not the days of David and Solomon. The building had not been fashioned yet, had not been built yet that Solomon would build. This was the tabernacle. This is when the house of God was in tents. In the wilderness, it roamed. They could pick it up. They could move it. They could set it back down again. Since they had been in the promised land in the book of Joshua and in Judges, it was still a tent. And it had been resting in a place called Shiloh, about centrally located there in the country of Israel. It would be north of where Jerusalem would be. And so here Hannah didn't have any children, but Penina had plenty. And we don't see a great jealousy here. We don't see a bunch of fleshly attitude, but we do see a spiritually minded person. I want you to also notice here that there's a great lack of men of God at this time. We must recognize this. Look, if you would, we know Eli is the high priest. Eli, now, the Bible doesn't say this, but it seems like he's past his prime. It seems like he should have retired already. But the high priest, I don't think that worked that way. But anyways, he had some sons that were helping him in the ministry. And look what the Bible says about his sons. Look in chapter 2, if you would. Look in chapter 2 and verse 12. The Bible says, "Now the sons of Eli were sons of Belial. They knew not the Lord." Can you imagine that? The sons of the priests are helping in the ministry, and they didn't even know God. It was all fake. It was all a big facade. It's sad when I look across America today and across the world and how many people are doing the work of God in pulpits and they're preaching things, heresy. They must not know the Lord. All religions lead to heaven. What kind of nonsense is that? That ain't Bible. That ain't Bible. And that man's going to die and go to hell. Listen now, unless he gets saved. Because three puffs of smoke out of some chimney does not make you holy as God. That's blasphemy. No, that's not the message today, but that was extra, so let's move on. Let's do a Bible, the Bible way, yes? Come on now. Doesn't matter how deep we run with what kind of religions. Let's do it God's way. Let's stop going man's way. Amen. Come on now. I was baptized as an infant. That's man's way. That's not God's way. And I realized that the Bible teaches that after I got saved, I had to get rebaptized. That's where our name Baptist came from. Anabaptists, rebaptizers. That's where we got our name. Amen. Come on now. Why? Doing it the Bible way. Doing it the Bible way. Amen. Now let's get back on here. Okay, these men were wicked men. The Bible says here, look at verse 24 of chapter 2. Eli speaking to his sons, he says, "Nay, my sons, for it is no good report that I hear. Ye make the Lord's people to transgress." They were wicked men, and they were causing the people of God to transgress. Now, there was a great need for godly men at this time. We see if you were to continue reading through chapter 1, Hannah goes and she's praying before God, and Eli thinks she's drunk. He can't even discern spiritual things. Here's this woman crying her heart out to God before the Lord here, before the altar, and yet he's marking her like she's just a drunkard. And there's a great need for spiritual men. Why is Hannah, why does she stick out here in the Scriptures? Why does God write much about this woman here? Samuel would go on to be a great prophet, and yet Hannah is remembered here, a couple chapters of her doing some great things. Hannah had great faith, and I want to point out a few things to you, to her today. I believe, number one today, she desired and she believed. She desired and she believed. Now follow me, I'm going to be on this a little bit and just help us understand. What am I saying by that? She desired and believed. She had a desire for a child. Isn't that what she says in verse 11? Okay, go back to chapter 1 and verse 11. The Bible says here in chapter 1, verse 11, the Bible says, "And she vowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if thou wilt indeed look on the affliction of thine handmaid and remember me, and not forget thine handmaid, but will give unto thine handmaid a man-child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head." The no razor thing has to do with a vow. When a Jewish man made a vow, he would then shave his head and his beard completely, and then he wouldn't allow another razor to come upon his head for the rest of that vow. Sometimes that vow was from birth. Okay, Samson would be one of those, and others, we see that. Samuel would be one of those, where not from birth would a razor come on the head, and it showed an outward picture of the inward vow that was made before God. Some of that was called, sometimes you learn about a Nazarite, and a Nazarite would have a vow and different things. Here was a vow that Mama made, and she said, "He won't have a razor on his head all the days of his life, because I've given him to God. He is set apart." He would look different on the outside because he was set apart for God. I think we could preach on that for a little while. I'm not preaching on you to have long hair. I'm preaching on you about being set apart, about looking different. Yeah, God teaches and preaches about being separate. He teaches and preaches about Christians looking different, sounding different, and not fitting into this world that we're living in. Amen and amen. Now we could preach on that for a while, but we'll get back to the message. She asked for a son here, and she asked for it. She went to God. She didn't go around asking everybody else about it. There's something about what's going on nowadays. Everybody's got their hand out. Listen here, I don't believe this is right. We say, well, we have this some great need, and we run to everybody we can and tell everybody all this what we need. That I don't see that in the Bible. I see we go to the Lord. What happened to having faith and trusting in God to fulfill your needs? Well, why do we got to run to everybody else and tell everybody else about it and expect the church and about this guy and that church and these people and the government and everybody else to fulfill all our needs? How about we rest in God to fulfill our needs? Amen. That's called faith. And here this woman does that. She does that. She prays to the Lord. Hannah, praise to God. But notice here, she left it in God's hands. Okay, watch this. And look at verse 18, would you please? Look at verse 18. For chapter 1, verse 18. The Bible says, and she said, let thine handmaid find grace in thy sight. So the woman went her way and did eat, and her countenance was no more sad. And they rose up in the morning early and worshiped before the Lord. See that? She gave her request to God, and she left it in His hands, and then she got up and she said, you know what? I don't need to be crying in front of everybody. I don't need to be taking this before everybody else. I don't need to do all these other things. I gave it to God. I believe Him. I trust Him. If He wants me to have it, He's going to give it to me. And her countenance was changed. She wasn't sad anymore. She wiped her tears. Remember when David did that? He went before the Lord and prayed for that little child that was dying. Remember that? And then he got up from there. He shaved himself. He bathed. He cleaned up himself. And he said, you know what? God will take care of this. If God's going to answer this, He's going to answer it. I trust God. Amen. And she did that. She left it in God's hands. Her countenance was changed and she went her way. Now, she desired and she believed on God. But number two, I want you to see this. Watch now. She delivered and was blessed. Where are you going with that? Now watch this now. Let's pick up on verse 20. No, let's read verse 19. We'll start verse 19. The Bible says, and they rose up in the morning early and worshiped before the Lord and returned and came to their house to Ramah. And Elkanah knew Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her. Isn't that what she asked for? Lord, remember me. Remember me. Yeah, remember your handmaid. I'm barren. You know the situation. And God knew exactly where she was, and she just asked Him to remember. Now, verse 20. Wherefore it came to pass, when the time was come about after Hannah had conceived, that she bare a son and called his name Samuel, saying, because I have asked of him of the Lord. And the man Elkanah and all his house went up to offer unto the Lord the yearly sacrifice and his vow. But Hannah went not up, for she said unto her husband, I will not go up until the child be weaned, and then I will bring him that he may appear before the Lord and there abide forever. And Elkanah, her husband, said unto her, do what seemeth thee good. Tarry until thou hast weaned him. Only the Lord establish his word. So the woman abode and gave her son suck until she had weaned him. Now, nowadays, a lot of folks nurse children, or a lot of ladies nurse children different lengths of time. In this culture, in this Eastern culture, this Jewish culture at this time, they would nurse for approximately 2 to 3 years until they were fully weaned here. And so it gives you an idea, as I was reading about that and trying to understand the history there. Samuel's going to be about somewhere between 2 and 3 years old when he's presented before God here. But here, if we were to stop right at this moment, it's like she's staying at home. She got a son from the Lord, and she's staying at home, and she's keeping him to herself. But wait a minute, we know the rest of the story, don't we? We know the rest of the scripture. The Bible says that she went and she presented him to the Lord. Look at verse 24. And when she had weaned him, she took him up with her, with 3 bullocks and with an ephah of flour and a bottle of wine. That's just an offering before God. And brought him unto the house of the Lord in Shiloh, and the child was young. And they slew a bullock and brought the child to Eli. Now that's a lot of faith right there, mamas. Okay, Eli didn't do very well raising his boys. And she's about to turn over her only son to this man. That's a lot of faith. That's trust in God, isn't it? Verse 25, and they slew a bullock and brought the child to Eli. And she said, oh, my Lord! As thy soul liveth, my Lord, I am the woman that stood by thee here, praying unto the Lord. For this child I prayed, and the Lord hath given me my petition, which I asked of him. Therefore also I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he liveth, he shall be lent to the Lord. And he worshiped the Lord there. Praise God for that. She delivered when God delivered the promise to her. God fulfilled her request, and then she turned around and delivered again on her promise. There's a lot of folks that are going back on promises these days. Come on now, when we make a vow before God, we ought to keep it. When we make a vow before other people, we should keep it. I believe if we make a vow to make a payment to a bank or to a car loan or to a house loan, we ought to pay it. I believe that's right. I believe it's called having character. And sometimes you might get in a little trouble and you have to say, hey, I'm having a little trouble. Would you be patient with me? But you still do the work and make the payment. Why? Because I believe it's doing right. Yeah, come on now. The Bible says you vow a vow, you ought to pay it. That's what the Bible says. And here she's made a vow before the Lord. And she says, Lord, if you give me a man child, I'm going to give him back to you. I'm going to lend him to you for the rest of his life. Now think about that. She doesn't have any children, and God gives her a baby. And I've been around people that they pray for a child, and they pray for a child, and they pray for a child. Get the whole church praying, I want to have a baby, and the Lord's not allowed that yet. Or sometimes maybe the child is sick or whatever, praying for the child. And then wouldn't you know, the child is born, and mom and dad are gone. Where'd you go? Well, we got a newborn at home. You know, things are different. Well, that's a nice excuse. I don't see that in the Word of God. God didn't say, well, don't forsake the assembling yourselves together except if you have a newborn. You follow me on that thing? I don't see that in the Word of God. And I understand there's every situation is a little different. But listen here, we ought to be faithful to God. We ask God for something, He delivers something, and we ought to be faithful in return. I believe that. And here the church has prayed and prayed and prayed for this child or for this baby to come, and yet the baby is delivered and mom and dad are gone. They're off the scene. And I believe Hannah here is fulfilling her promise to the Lord. Praise God for it. Now, notice this. I want you to see this. God, listen here, He fulfilled her request. She then delivered on that promise, and God blessed her for it. I had forgotten about this until recently. I was reading along here, and I've forgotten about this. Notice, if you would, follow with me now. We're in 1 Samuel 2. Notice here in verse number, let's start in 18, verse number 18. This is 1 Samuel 2, 18. Bible says, but Samuel ministered before the Lord, being a child girded with a linen ephod. Okay, wait a minute. Let me just stop there for a minute. Before you start gifting your children to the church and they're 2 and 3 years old to the preacher, let's talk first, okay? Okay, just let's just have a little counseling session before we're making all these vows, all right? I'm sure some of you got some 2-year-olds that you love to gift over to your preacher, okay? But we're having fun with that. But listen, this is a serious thing. She didn't have a child and she asked a child of God. And she said, God, I'll give him to you. All right, verse 19. Moreover, his mother made him a little coat and brought it to him from year to year when she came up with her husband to offer the yearly sacrifice. Can you imagine how difficult that was? Mamas, your precious little baby. You pray for this baby. It's your only child. And you bring it in. But I don't get to live with him. But I have a child. And I get to make a coat for him. I get to go see him. Maybe once. Maybe another time of the year. We'll see. And watch. God's using him. You know, there's something going on. We believe in the will of God. And we believe in surrendering to the will of God. And then it comes to our children and our grandchildren. Be cautious on that thing. I've watched people, really and honestly, I've watched them take a bucket of water and throw on the flames of what God's doing in the heart of young people. Well, I don't want my grandchild going to wherever. We always pick the worst place. Africa, right, with all the snakes and spiders. In the jungles of Congo or whatever. We pick that. And we go, I don't want my child going there. I want my child home for Christmas. God can use them, but He can't take them there. Wait a minute. Be cautious on this thing. Is God in charge or is He not in charge? Because they're safer in the jungles of Congo than they are on the streets of Martinsburg if they're out of God's will. With me now? Watch me on that thing. Help me with that. Okay? Now, look as we're continuing here. She made a coat. Went up year to year. Look at verse 20. And Eli blessed Elkanah and his wife and said, the Lord give thee seed of this woman for the loan which is lent to the Lord. And they went unto their own home. Watch this. Verse 21. And the Lord visited Hannah, so that she conceived and bare 3 sons and 2 daughters. And the child Samuel grew before the Lord. Wow. Here she asked God for something that she didn't have because she desired to give it back to the Lord. She saw a need of godly men, a dearth, if you will. And she said, Lord, if you just give me one, I'll give him back to you. And God gave her one and she didn't keep it for herself. She then returned it back to the Lord. She saw a need, she had a desire, and God fulfilled that, and she gave it back to the Lord. And then God blessed her for it. She delivered and was blessed. You realize that? She was a barren woman, no children, and she had five more children after Samuel. What a blessing. And I know we've heard people talk, well, just because you give to the Lord or just because you sacrifice this doesn't mean God's going to give back. Oh, He's going to bless you. It's not always in the things in the way that we think He ought to, you know, just adding zeros on the bank account. But God's going to bless you, and He's going to bless you greatly. You don't believe me? Ask folks that have been given and sacrificing of themselves for the Lord's work for years and years and years and see how God's blessed them. I tried the world's way. I tried my way. I tried working and building a career and doing some things and having fun my way, doing it my way. Listen now, and I'm telling you what, I have more liberty and freedom, and it seems like I've got more money in my pocket because I've been given to God and gave my life to Him first, then given my money to Him, and I'm watching God's blessings come back on me. I'm watching that. I wouldn't have my wife. I wouldn't have my children. I wouldn't have my home and this wonderful church if I had not given myself first to the Lord. I wouldn't have that. You know what I'd have? I'd have a mound full of debt trying to live for myself and chase the dollar. That's what I'd have because that's what I had before I gave myself to the Lord. Hannah desired and she believed it was possible. God responded to her faith. God always responds to faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please Him, but He always responds to faith. Hannah then delivered on her promise, and she was blessed by God. God again responded to her faith. You think that didn't take faith, dropping her little 2.5-year-old off to Eli, who had some trouble raising his own kids? You didn't think that took a little faith? God responded to her faith. She said, I made a promise. God delivered on His side. I'm going to deliver on mine. I'm going to deliver on mine. Now, if you would, please, take your Bibles with me and go over to 2 Corinthians, please. 2 Corinthians, and we're going to end here today. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Missions Conference is approaching. It is my desire for us, church, to be a church of faith and ask God to do something great through us for reaching the world for Christ. I believe that is a biblical mandate that we reach the world, and I believe we can do it through the ministry of the local church here. And I believe it's been being done for a long time, and we're going to continue and ask God to do it even more this year. I'm asking you, church family, you individually, as a Christian, will you desire and believe? I have believed in missions a long time. And every time I come to missions, God's just poking my heart. But am I doing enough? There are so many people in this world today. So many people. More people now than ever have been. And they're dying and going to hell. Because I'm selfish. Because I want to sit on my hands. Because I'm not willing to go, I'm not willing to give. You follow me on that thing? When the whole purpose of my life is to give glory to Jesus and tell other people about Him. And I get convicted about, am I doing enough? Am I doing enough? Will you desire and will you believe? I believe in our church, I don't believe there's a single person that can't be involved in giving to missions. I don't believe there's a single person that can't be involved. God doesn't talk about dollar amounts when we're talking about giving to missions. And I want to show you that here in just a minute. He didn't talk about dollar amounts, but He does say, if you give sparingly, you're going to reap sparingly. But He does say, if you give bountifully, you're going to reap bountifully. I want you to see some of this today. Do you believe God can provide for your desire to be a part of His work? Do you believe that? Do you have a desire to be a part of His work? Think about that. I want to give and see God use it, but sometimes I lack in faith and I say, wow, man, I want to give more, but how are we going to do that? How are we going to do that? You know, as I look back at Marie and I and what we give now towards Faith Promise, I'm not talking about tithe. Tithe is 10%. We know that. God has required us to give 10% of our increase, and we give it through the tithes here of the local church. We understand that. But we're talking about faith. We're talking about Faith Promise, that offering above and beyond that. God obviously talks about that. He says tithes and offerings in His scriptures. And we're getting ready for Faith Promise, and I'm trying to prepare my own heart. God, whatever you ask of me, am I going to be faithful to say yes and to do it? I've got to get ready as your pastor for Faith Promise. I've got to do it. I don't believe we should go backwards. I believe we should go forward. What am I saying by that? I believe that the Woolard household should be giving more this year than we did last year. That's what I'm saying. Really? Yeah, I believe that. Why? Because there's more people in this world that need to be reached for the gospel. Things cost more. We want to see more missionaries go to the field. I want to see more of Europe reached this year. Amen. Say, well, I ask for things and God doesn't answer my prayer. Wait a minute, let's be cautious here for a second. James chapter 4 says, ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lusts. A lot of times we're asking for things just for our own selfish benefit. Hannah here asked for a son, I believe, because there was a great need for a godly man in that land. And God gave her that. And then she was able to return it. Amen. Now, let's go, please. We're in 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Follow me on this. Will you be faithful to deliver on the promise? So here, the Corinthian people, had made a promise to be a part of God's work in ministering to other saints. Okay? Notice, if you would, here in chapter 8, look at verse 10, would you please? Verse 10. Paul is writing back to these Corinthians. They've made a promise to be a part of helping others. And he says here in verse 10, and herein I give my advice. This is chapter 8, verse 10 of 2 Corinthians. And herein I give my advice, for this is expedient for you who have begun before not only to do, but also to be forward a year ago. In other words, they made a promise. They said, we're going to promise that we're going to give this a year ago. Now, therefore, perform the doing of it. That as there was a readiness to will, so that there may be a performance also out of that which ye have. Okay? He's saying, you made a promise. You had a willingness to help others in need. You had a willingness to send missionaries. You had a willingness to send money to this church over here to be a help to this thing over here. He's saying, you made a promise. Now fulfill it. Are you going to come through on your promise? That's what he's saying here. Notice, if you would, go down to chapter 9. Look at verse 1. In case you're wondering what he's talking about, he says it here in verse 1. For as touching the ministering to the who? To the saints. That's people that are saved. For as touching the ministering to the saints, it is superfluous for me to write to you. In other words, it's not needful. It's above and beyond that I write to you about it. You're already giving. For I know the forwardness of your mind, for which I boast of you to them of Macedonia. That Achaia, I know I'm butchering that, forgive me. That what that means is Greece. Okay, Achaia is the land of Greece, and the Corinthians are part of Greece. It says, I boast of you to them of Macedonia, that Achaia, or Greece, was ready a year ago, and your zeal hath provoked very many. Yet have I sent the brethren, lest our boasting of you should be in vain in this behalf, that I said, ye may be ready. Lest happily, if they of Macedonia come with me and find you unprepared, we, that we say not ye, should be ashamed in this same confident boasting. Therefore, I thought it necessary to exhort the brethren that they would go before unto you and make up beforehand your bounty, whereof ye had noticed before, that the same might be ready as a matter of bounty and not as covetousness. We're talking about an offering here and giving to another work. And he says, you made a promise on it. And God, and he's we're going to go on here, but he's going to explain. He says, God is able to fulfill that promise for you. And so then you have to then return it back to the Lord. And he goes on to teach this. Will you and I respond the same way as Hannah? Will we see a need that is present and say, God, I don't know how I'm going to fulfill that need. I don't know how you're going to do all this, but I do see a need and I want to be a part of your work. Take it before the Lord. We have 3.5 weeks, he said, Brother William said, before missions conference. Take it before the Lord. Lord, what would you allow myself, my family to do for missions this year? Maybe we need to take this thing of helping this hurricane relief home to the Lord this afternoon. God, what part would you have me to be in this thing? I see there's a great need. I see it. But how am I going to be a part of this? Show me what I'm supposed to do. Increase my faith. Faith. That's what we're talking about here. Notice the rest of the scripture. Watch this now. Notice verse number 6. And I'll be on this and then we'll be done. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly, I'm in chapter 9, verse 6. He which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. He which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of a necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. What he's talking about, that a lot of folks use that when they're talking about offerings. That is not talking about tithe right there. That's talking about above and beyond giving towards missions. That's the context is missions. Verse 1 said, touching the ministering to the saints. And so what he's saying there is your offering, what God has not required, above and beyond, as the Lord leads in your heart to be a part of it, then do it. And as God is leading in you to be a part of faith promise above and beyond that, then allow him to work that through you and he's going to supply your need. Look what it says, verse 8. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that ye always, having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. Now, I had to read that a couple times to understand that. But you know what that's saying right there? It's saying that God can give you exactly what you need to be a part of his work. Look, let's read it again. Verse 8. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that ye always having all sufficiency in all things, you have enough, may abound to every good work. As it is written, he hath dispersed abroad, he hath given to the poor, his righteousness remaineth forever. God gives what he wants to give. You make a promise to the Lord. You say, Lord, I want to be a part of faith promise. I want to be a part of this thing, but I don't know. I've never budgeted. I don't know how to do all this. I don't know what I'm supposed to give. We in faith. Lord, give me a number. Help me to believe you. That's what Mrs. Willard and I do. We don't go to the checkbook. I make a budget every week. Brother Rocky, you're going to start teaching financial peace this Wednesday. I believe in making a budget. I make a budget every month. But for faith promise, I don't go to the budget. Why? What are you talking about? Are you serious? You're telling us not to go, not to plan it out? I'm telling you, I take it to the Lord. I say, God, I need you to give me the number. I have a desire to increase. Show me the way. Teach me. Give me that number. Show me the way. And then I make the commitment, and then I know that God will supply it because he's the one that gave me the number, and he's the one that promised to supply it. Right there, he said I'd have all sufficiency in all things. He supplies it. Amen? We're getting ready for missions conference. Are we ready to respond in faith? Are we ready to follow the Lord in faith? I'm going to close my Bible here. Here it is, church. Listen now. I know we've talked a lot about money today, and it's rightfully so. The Bible talks about money. I don't believe money's supposed to be a hindrance for us. Brother Rocky, we're having this program on Wednesday night starting because money's not supposed to be a hindrance to us. God gave us a way in which we are to have some wisdom with our money. And I believe if you're not tithing, you're shooting yourself in the foot to begin with, because God's promised that he'd open up his windows of heaven and pour his blessings out. He promised us. And then above and beyond that missions, I believe we wouldn't be financially in the state that we're in if we weren't given to missions, because God said he's going to supply all our needs, take care of us, and give us what we need to be a part of God's work. I believe the reason the Willard household is stable when it comes financially is because we're giving to the work of God. I believe that. I'm not just preaching you something I don't believe. I'm doing what I'm telling you what I'm finding in the Word of God. Praise the Lord for it. Before we came to Shenandoah, Okay, we were in a different part of the country and mortgages and different time, all that stuff. Everything was a little different. Our biggest check that we wrote every month was to the church for God's work. Praise God for that. And I was pleased with that. I'm not trying to brag to you. I'm just telling you, I love that. We moved down here and God changed a few things and the market was a little different, wasn't it, Brother Rocky? It was a little different down here and mortgages and all that. It's not that case anymore, but I'm praying maybe the Lord will let it return. Why? Because God can do some great and amazing things. And if I am going to be the preacher preaching the Word of God, I've got to lead the way in this. I believe that. And I know, Maria and I, we don't go backwards on faith promise. Well, we've had a hard year. We can't commit that much this year. No, I'm going to have faith in God that He wants us to grow. And we're just going to keep growing. And I always, this is just personal opinion, but I believe tithe is where we start. I always increase tithe when I increase faith promise. I do that. Why? Because God's work's got to go forward. And I just believe in that. And God rewards us. He blesses us. He fulfills His promise. Hannah, what did she do? She desired and believed. She delivered and was blessed for it. Are you and I going to do that same thing? Are we going to really say that we're truly Christians and we're going to take the whole counsel of God and we're going to live it and we're going to believe it? Or when it gets a little tough on this money situation, are we just going to throw it out the window? Are we going to be faithful to God in everything? Or just the easy things? Now, with all that being said, you might be here today and you might not be saved. You say, I don't understand money. And you're talking about, giving money to God. I just don't understand that. I'm going to ask you a question. Do you know for sure you're going to heaven? Do you know if you died right now, or if Jesus came back right now, that you, when the roll is called up yonder, you'd be there? Do you know that? You must be born again. And if you don't know that you're born again, then forget all the money stuff I've just talked about and ask yourself this. If Jesus came now, would He take me to heaven? Am I saved? And if you're not saved, in just a moment, we're going to have some men up here and some ladies up here also with Bibles. We're glad to show you from the Bible how you can become a Christian, a child of God, and get born again. Let's bow together. Lord, help us now, please. Lord, I know this was a teaching time more so, some preaching, but leading the church in the way that we should act in faith and giving of ourselves, Lord, and our money to You. And I pray that, Lord, we would be people of faith. God, that we would grow to say, Lord, what would You have me to do? What part do You have me to do? Lord, I don't believe that we should be giving our money when we're not willing to give ourselves. Lord, help us to be willing to give ourselves and our time and our efforts, Lord, and our money, Lord, as You have given all for us. May we return that to You. Help us, please.